time evolves and comes to a place where it renews again. There is first a purification time, then there's renewal time. We are getting very close to this time now. We were told that we would see America come and go. And in a sense, America is dying from within because they forgot the instructions on how to live on Earth. Everything is coming to a time where prophecy and man's inability to live on Earth in a spiritual way will come to a crossroad of great problems. It's the Hopi belief, it's our belief that if you're not spiritually connected to the Earth and understand the spiritual reality of how to live on Earth, it's likely you will not make it. When Columbus came, that began what we term as the First World War. That was the true First World War when Columbus arrived. Because along with him came everybody from Europe. By the end of the Second World War, in America, we were only 800,000 from 60 million to 800,000. So we were almost exterminated here in America. Everything is spiritual. Everything has a spirit. Everything was brought to you by the Creator, the one Creator. Some people call him God. Some people call him Buddha. Some people call him Allah. Some people call him other names. We call him Tonkashila, Grandfather. We're here on Earth only a few winters. Then we go to the spirit world. The spirit world is more real than most of us believe. The spirit world is everything. Over 95% of our body is water. And in order to stay healthy, you've got to drink good water. When the European first came here, Columbus, we could drink out of any river. If the Europeans had lived the Indian way when they came, we'd still be drinking out of water because water is sacred. The air is sacred. Our DNA is made of the same DNA as the tree. The tree breathes what we exhale. When the tree exhales, we need what the tree exhales. So we have a common destiny with the tree. We are all from the earth. And when the earth, the water, the atmosphere is corrupted, then it will create its own reaction. Mother is reacting. In the Hopi prophecy, they say the storms and floods will become greater. To me, it's not a negative thing to know that there will be great changes. It's not negative. It's evolution. When you look at it as evolution, it's time. Nothing stays the same.
Sedan Darwin skrev sitt berömda verk om arternas uppkomst har vetenskapen varit övertygad om att människan härstammar från aporna.
We always say that might be your ancestor, but it's not our ancestor. He is a relative, but not our ancestor. You should learn how to plant something. That's the first connection. You should treat all things as spirit. Realize that we are one family. It's never something like the end. Just like life, there is no end to life.
That's about seed, that's about life. Seventh generation is about vision. It's about leadership, looking ahead. It's about responsibility. And seventh generation reminds you that you have responsibility to generations that are coming, and that you indeed are in charge of life as it is at the moment. Every generation has its time, and every generation has its leaders, and every generation has its heroes. Every generation has all of that. And when that generation passes, the next generation will have the same. They will also have their leaders, they will also have their heroes, they will also have their problems, and they will also have the continuing responsibility to look out for the next seven generations.
All you gotta do is copy them.
You have to raise your own leaders. They're not gonna come out of the air. They're not gonna come from what you can see around. You gotta start it just the way a little plant grows. You gotta do that. Raise your leaders.
And how do you go about that, raising your leaders? Is that with the attitude?
Well, first of all, you have to observe that all children have a common leader. You watch children play, and it doesn't take you very long when you can see who the leader is. And now you have to guide that person. And you have to deal with that person. Then you have to recognize that that person really understands. And so maybe by the time they're a little child, whether it's a boy or a girl, you've been observant for 19, 25 years. And comes time to move, and then you walk in and you know who you're talking to, because there's natural leaders. The most important thing I would think is that the leadership change their values from power and authority to responsibility. I don't think, as in the United States, they have a Bill of Rights, you know, that they added on to the Constitution of the United States. And I think that should have been a Bill of Responsibility, not a Bill of Rights. Because people talk about their rights, but they never talk about their responsibility. And leadership has got to have that above all. They've got to have vision. They've got to have compassion for the future. They've got to make that decision for the seventh generation. That's not just a casual term. That's a real instruction for survival. Animal, every bird, every nation, every plant has its own area to be. And you respect that. You know, as we sit here and we look about us, there are these flowers. And no tree grows by itself. A tree is a community. Certain trees, certain plants will gather around certain trees. And certain medicines will gather around those certain plants. So that if you kill all the trees, if you cut all the trees, then you're destroying the community. You're not just destroying a tree, you're destroying a whole community that surrounds it and thrives on it, and that may be very important medicine for people or for animals, because animals know the same medicine. They use this medicine. Well, that's where we learned. We learned, you know, by watching the animals. They taught us a lot. Where is the medicine? They'll tell you, because they use it themselves.
And then if you replant the tree, you don't replant the community, you replant the tree. So you've lost a community. And if you clear cut, which is what's happening in America and Canada a great deal these days, and I guess around the world, then you are really a very destructive force. And simply replanting trees is not replanting community. You lost a lot in the process. If you don't understand that, you will. And that understanding comes in a very difficult manner.
That of the 100 dominant economic units in the world today, the 100 largest economic units, and that's the word they use, was units, 49 are countries and 51 are corporations. Now, you digest that for a second. What does that mean? It means that corporations are the driving force of decision making today. And corporations are not concerned with human rights. They're not concerned with human life. They're not even concerned with a proper wage for the people that are working for them. So what kind of decisions are going to be made on our behalf by this economic power, these corporate states, I call them? Oh, there's going to be hell to pay, as they say, for some of the things that are going on now. So I think that people have to become aware and become awake, and not, and power is always in the people's hands, authority. They need to come of one mind, and they need to challenge the values that are being shoved at them today, because this has become a consumer society. It's driven by economics. It's not driven by common sense. It's economics.
But do all people have the possibility to work from common sense instead?
Well, everybody's born with common sense. That's why they call it common sense. You know, I mean, you have common sense. You just got to use it, that's all. And you got to just evaluate what somebody tells you. You know, if you use your common sense, you say, well, that doesn't work. No, I don't think so. I mean, I remember when one of our chiefs, we had a group of boys who had done something bad, and they were sitting in front of the chief's council, and they were talking about, you know, who was the leader. And I remember the chief, an old chief, said, well, he said, you know, it's not good sense to follow somebody just because why? You can't give me an answer why you follow him, but if he were going to do something like jumping off a cliff, would you follow him? Would you do that? Use your sense. Use your common sense. And then he said, everybody should be their own leader. In other words, do your thinking for yourself.
Будут участвовать в этих...
Nineveh, to have God that is talking in the latter days. And you can bring that to us. There will be no excuses.
Now we see flames. We are seeing flames coming out of
the compound is on fire.
Thank you.
some decisions. And I think that the leadership that we're looking for has to come from business. Very, very important now, because business carries more authority, and they carry the economics of the world. Today, we're bound together much closer than we were so many years ago, 1,000 years ago. We're neighbors, and we're bound together by electronics. We're bound together by technology, and the world has become, quote, a market. And it's this market that we have to deal with. And it's this idea of boundless and endless resources. And when you say resources, you're talking about our relatives. You're talking about our family. Fish are our family. It's not a resource, it's a family. It requires all the respect. The structure of the world itself is such, it functions on natural law, and the natural law is a powerful regenerative process. There's a process of regeneration that continues and grows and is endless. It's absolutely endless if everyone agrees to the law and follows the law. But if you challenge the law, and you think you're going to change the law, then you're bound to failure. And in that failure will be a lot of pain, because the natural law has no mercy. It is only the law. All-powerful. Wasn't made here for human beings. He said, we're part of it. But we don't have to be here, because the earth has its own process. And if it becomes to the point where you destroy yourself as human beings, and you destroy life and finally leave this earth, the earth's not going to disappear. There's not going to be an end of the world. That's really a very interesting concept to us. No, the world won't end. People's life on it will. So it's not the end of the world you're talking about, it's the end of us. And the world, no matter what damage you think you've done to it, will regenerate, will re-green, we'll redo everything that was here at one time, except there won't be any people. Because it's got all the time in the world. I said, now, as you're coming down the final stretch, you're racing towards the finish, and there is the stone wall, and you're not pulling your horse. You're not stopping. You're in fact accelerating. I said, now, that's the way I see the use of what you call resources. You're using them faster than they're reproducing. And you're headed towards that disaster, and none of you are pulling your horse. I said, take the example of a car race or racing cars. They have a yellow flag. When there's an accident or something, a yellow flag comes out, everybody gets into line, and they slow down, and they have sort of a common sense about that, at least. I said, do you have a concept of a yellow flag? Is there a yellow flag amongst your ideas or your thinking here? And one of the gentlemen, and they were all men, maybe 50 to 60, 65, he said, you know, he said, I understand what you're saying, but to answer your question, no, we can't. We can't pull our horse, as you say, because, he said, We have to show a profit. As a CEO, I must show a profit. If I don't show a profit, he said, I'm fired. Simple as that. I'm out of a job. I have to show a profit. I said, to who? He said, to you, the stockholder. I said, well, are you married? He said, yes, I am. I said, do you have children? He said, yes, I do. I said, do you have any grandchildren? He said, I have two boys. I said, when do you cease to be a CEO and become a grandfather? There was a lot of silence there because that was a moral question. And if you don't have a moral question in your governing process, then you don't have a process that's going to survive. That's the governing law, the moral question. You must have a moral society or you won't have any. He couldn't answer the question, neither could anyone else, because it was a moral question. That's what we have to get back to. So they said, well, got kind of heavy silence there. So they said, look, you're a Indian, and we keep hearing about Indian prophecies. Can you give us a prophecy? Can you tell us a prophecy? And of course, I told him a lot, because I know a lot of them. But at that particular moment, I said, certainly I can. And I can guarantee it. I said, really? Well, what is it? I said, next year you'll meet and nothing will have changed. And again, there was silence. We're moving in a very direct line to that stone wall. I do not believe personally that we have passed the line or the point of no return. But we're approaching it. We're approaching it. And every day that you don't do what's right is a day that you've lost an option. And you're losing your options every day.
When we are brought to this earth, we have a mission. Everyone has a mission.
And how can you find out about
it? You don't look for it. People drive themselves crazy trying to find it. But it comes to you. It's in your being. And sometimes people have to travel many, many years before they'll realize that they've been that way all the time. They just didn't recognize it or didn't know how to. They had been exercising it without being totally conscious. Sent a messenger, and we call him in English the peacemaker.
and he came, and he, again, he brought a message of peace. And the power in the message was, it was only words, the teachings, that compelled these people to believe and take up the way of peace.
When he first gathered the chiefs together on Onondaga Lake, which is not far from here, this great lake at this time, he gathered all the leaders together, and then that's when the instructions began.
So he would watch from the bush until he could discern who was the most powerful man in this village, this settlement, who was the one most feared, or who was the most evil and fearsome man here. And that is the one he approached when he found out who that was. And there's an illustration in every step of the stories as they are told. Illustrations of how we should live and how things can be if you follow the peaceful path.
Why did the peacemaker choose the most feared and most evil man?
Because the message that he was bringing was a message that was going to bring about these people who didn't know what it was anymore for a person to die naturally. Everybody just died from being killed by another human.
No one knows exactly how long ago, but at least 1,000 years, and probably more. But at least 1,000 years ago, this peacemaker brought this message to our people. Because we were in warfare, we were fighting, it was a terrible time. It's similar very much to what's happening in Bosnia now, where the inter-fighting amongst the people themselves was going to be what they call attrition. It was attrition. You never gave up, one side never got even. You kill, I kill, you kill, I kill, you kill, I kill. And he came at that time when we were in that kind of position, when the leaders were the strongest, not necessarily the wisest. When it was the strength that was in charge and in command, and the women and children were frightened of their own men. They would not be even in the same house. They would run and hide because it was so fierce. And it was at that time this peacemaker, this messenger, brought us this message of the great law, the great peace is what it amounts to.
And so the message that he was bringing was a respect for life and thanksgiving for life and living things. And so these men who were so feared by everyone, they enjoyed that life that they were living. And so it was not totally their vision that they should turn into such a peaceful person, that no one would be afraid of them anymore. Finally, he accepted totally the message of peace. And so because he had been such a powerful person, to appease him, he was given that very special seat at the head of the council that was now being formed. And he was going to be named the firekeeper of all these other councils who now became one.
And this was after he gave all the instructions on how to counsel. He gave the power and the authority and the responsibility to the different groups. He said the men would be responsible for the council, to use their good minds now. Instead of fighting, they would now use reason and law. Law would be the basis, and you'll use your mind and you will not fight. And you will sit in council, and he said, we'll call this the council of the good minds. And he said, and the women who are fundamental to life and female, as we all look around and we talk about the seed, well, this is the female. Again, you know, you see down here, this is her work. Her work. I mean, without it, we all have seed. We're seed at one time, ourselves.
comes from the two, the partner, the male and the female. Everything you see here is in twos. Nothing is by itself. Nothing can move by itself. This is his instruction. And so the female carries life. She is fundamentally important. Without that female, there is no life. None. Ever. Anywhere.
And so that is the story of how the peacemaker, the message of peace that the peacemaker brought to the people, was able to convert these people into a peaceful society. And that's when the structure of all this leadership, this chieftainship, began.
And we've been doing our best to continue that, and here I stand today as a member of the council that he set up so long ago with the same principles, the same mandates, but certainly in a different time and a different place. No less and probably more responsibility. And we look about, and we look about for allies, we look about for friends, we look about for people who will understand and agree with those mandates of peace. And that is what we're talking about today, because that is the mandates for life. One of the other instructions that we were given is that we are now placing in your hands all life. And it is your responsibility and it is your duty to look after all life. And so when he was speaking like that, he wasn't talking about our aunts and our uncles and our cousins and our fathers and our mothers. He was talking about all life. He was talking about the trees. He was talking about the fish, the animals, everything that grows. Everything with life, because it is a family. We are a family, all life. Our brothers and our sisters to the west of us, called the Lakota people, have a way of finishing their prayer, their thanksgiving, and they say, "All my relations." And when they say "all my relations," that is precisely what they're talking about. They're talking about all life. When we traveled and we talked with the Aboriginal people from Australia, they talked about the two laws. And when we questioned them about the two laws, they were talking about all life.
We give thanks for all of these. Every time we meet together, no matter how many or how few, the Thanksgiving address is given. It's an acknowledgement of the rest of living things in the creation, and it's a thanksgiving and our way of paying great respect for all of the rest of the creation, which we are only a part of this great big design for living. And if any one of the other components were to fall out from that cycle, there would be a great imbalance, and eventually it would collapse. It would be gone. We, as mankind, are the only ones who do not give to the rest of the cycle. For the rest of the cycle is constantly giving, giving, and giving. And we are constantly taking and taking and taking so that we might have life.
But even for American Indians, materialism and power has been very tempting lately.
They're human beings. I mean, everybody's human being. I mean, I look around and I see this pell-mell run for gaming, gambling, high-stakes casino. Indians got gold fever, just like the white man. So that's what I look at it and I see it's the same thing as the white man. We used to laugh at him because he was so crazy when it came to gold. Now we look at our own people and they're running around with the same look in their eye. And I'll tell you, it's not so funny anymore. Peace is it's an everyday fight. it's something that goes on all the time. You know, we believe that ourselves are one half the negative, one half the positive, and it's the balance that's important all the time, to keep the balance.
We also have patches about the longest walk. Again, this is how we're going to raise monies to get back. We're not going to ask Congress, we're not going to ask the White House or any agency or any grant money at all. We're going to go back the way we came, by the goodness of the people. And I want to say that the people out there were very generous. They're extremely generous. We'd arrive sometimes late at night, and they will have been waiting for us 6-7 hours, but they did wait, and they provided us with food, lots of food. And then as we began to cross the country, truck drivers were stopping, people were stopping and offering us cases and cases of water. So there, I know from that beginning, from the very fact that they did that, I know that the people in America are still good. There's still goodness in our people. No matter what this government does, what they commit themselves to do, engaging us in this war or that war, there are still some good people in this country. We crossed 35 Native reservations, 35 reservations from California, Arizona, New Mexico, Oklahoma, Louisiana, also in, they're not state, federal recognized, but state recognized in Alabama, also in North Carolina, Virginia. We met people who are doctors, physicians, lawyers, congressmen, mayors, governors. It was a great walk. And so we concluded it yesterday, and today's celebration for us. But I wanted this headdress here. It took a long time to get here to Washington, D.C. When Buffalo Bill had the Wild West days going in Europe, he asked Native people from Minnesota and South Dakota to go with them. So many people, Ojibwe people and Lakotas, went with them and performed during what they call the Wild West days in Europe. And of course they would have Indians riding odds and headdresses, and they would do mock battles. But one of the Ojibwe warriors went over there, they asked people to bring their traditional dress, and my great-great-grandfather was one of them that went over there, and he passed away in Europe. And but they somehow, the body came back, but all his belongings. And then in January of last year, a friend of mine was going through an antique shop and saw this in a glass encasement, and written in it was from the Ojibwe warrior, Bagnagijic. So I have it, he saw it, he said, Dennis, he called me from Paris, he said, Dennis, what is your Indian name? And I told him, and he said, is that Ojibwe or Chippewa? Of course he knows me only by Ojibwe. And he said it was a Chippewa warrior. So 90 some years later, the headdress comes back, and I've chosen this day to wear it, because sometimes you see Native people with headdresses on, they got regalia on, and this is what I wear. Jeans and a t-shirt, and I got running shoes or walking shoes. So I want to thank the drummers that came, and the singers, of course. A lot of dancers coming from different ways. Some of the dancers were with us on the longest walk. Chili, the grass dancer, was with us. Also, Wayne Crew, he's here.